I would like to thank Jan Kaysen, who not only serves as Truett Seminary's financial manager, but is also a very gifted pianist. Thank you, Jan, for leading us in worship this morning through your playing. I would also like to thank Manny Silva for praying for us this morning, and Hannah Bowman, who will read our scripture. As I welcome you to chapel, I would like to especially welcome Nancy Garland. Welcome. We're delighted that you're here. This morning, we continue our fall chapel series, Wonderful Words of Life. Our focus text is Romans 7:22, and our lecturer is Dr. David E. Garland. Dr. Garland really needs no introduction to this group. He began teaching at Truett Seminary in 1997 and served as the seminary's fourth dean from 2007 to 2015. During that time frame, he also served as Baylor's interim president from August 08 to May 10, and as the university's interim provost from July 2014 to June 2015. All on top of serving as the seminary's dean. Then from June 2016 to May 2017, Dr. Garland served a second term as Baylor's interim president. For 21 years, Dr. Garland served on the faculty of the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, where he was chair of the biblical division from 1992 to 1997, and was the Ernest and Mildred Hogan Professor of New Testament Interpretation from 1993 to 1997. A Maryland native, magna cum laude graduate of Oklahoma Baptist University, and a U.S. Navy veteran, Dr. Garland received his Master of Divinity and his doctoral degree from Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. He also completed postdoctoral work, that is to say, work on sabbatical leaves at the University of Tübingen in Germany, and Macquarie University in Sydney, Australia. I first came to know Dr. Garland as the New Testament scholar that he is, well known, highly respected, having authored, co-authored, and edited 24 books, including commentaries on the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, as well as Acts 1 and 2 Corinthians, Colossians, and Philemon. Presently, and there's a connection here, Dr. Garland is concluding a commentary on Paul's magisterial letter to the Romans. Dr. Garland remains closely connected to local church ministry. He's preached to a lot of people in a lot of places and has served as interim pastor of 16 churches, not only in Kentucky and Indiana, but also in Texas. Dr. Garland, we're grateful for your gifts. We welcome you to lecture to us this morning. We will hear you gladly and gratefully. Let's continue in worship.
Good morning. Would you bow your heads with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we are honored that we are able to gather, God, when many are not. This is a blessing that I pray that we not take for granted, God, to rejoice for the gift that it is God, I pray in times where we are in most desperate need of you, Lord, in the world we are living where chaos, hate, and division seem to thrive, God, I pray that we would seek your love as our fuel, Lord, and that we would approach our brothers and sisters with humility, God, in our own unrighteousness before seeking to acknowledge theirs. God, we're grateful for Dr. Garland, for the servant and the humble leader that he is to not only Truett, but also, God, to your body. And so I pray that you would open our hearts to the word that he brings and that we may take it out into the world that needs it. And it's all things that we say, and we thank your son. Amen.
Dr. Garland's lecture text is Romans 7, 5 through 25. While we were living in the flesh, our sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit for death. But now we are discharged from the law, dead to that which held us captive, so that we are slaves not under the old written code, but in the new life of the Spirit. What then should we say? That the law is sin? By no means. Yet if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin. I would not have known what it is to covet if the law had not said, you shall not covet. But sin, seizing an opportunity in the commandment, produced in me all kinds of covetousness. Apart from the law, sin lies dead. I was once alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. And the very commandment that promised life proved to be death to me. For sin, seizing an opportunity in the commandment, deceived me, and through it killed me. So the law is holy, and the commandment is holy and just and good. Did what is good then bring death to me? By no means. It was sin, working death in me through what is good, in order that sin might be shown to be sin, and through the commandment might become sinful beyond measure. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold into slavery under sin. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but the sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self. But I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with my mind, I am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh, I am a slave to the law of sin. This is the word of the Lord.
for that very kind introduction. I do not thank you for asking me to preach on this passage. I was a bit taken aback because the title of the sermon series is Wonderful Words of Life. And Romans 7 does not seem to fit, since it is more about sin and death and the failure of the law to conquer sin and death. And this chapter is most complicated and much debated among scholars. And I have completed my commentary in Romans. I'm ready to send it off tomorrow. And I asked if I might lecture on this passage from my commentary. And so I'm very grateful that Dean Still said that was all right. That means this service is different from others. I might add a note about the scripture, which is in the plaque dedicated to Dr. Ray Summers in the bench out in the courtyard. And this name takes me back when last century I was an MDiv student at Southern Seminary and taking a baby Greek course using The Essentials of Biblical Greek by Ray Summers. That course sparked my interest and excitement about reading the New Testament in Greek and wanting to be a student of the New Testament. Little did I know that 5 years later I would be teaching out of this Essentials of New Testament Grammar for many years after that. Dr. Summers became a professor at Baylor and founded the graduate program at Baylor and has touched so many people's lives through his ministry and his writing. I also, in searching for a suitable hymn for Romans 7, was taken back to Southern Seminary. There are few hymns in the modern hymnals that I thought would fit Romans 7. But I did discover this one by Basil Manley Jr. back in 1850, that he was a founding member of the faculty at Southern when it began in 1859. And I did think that this, and I also love the tune, it's the Navy hymn tune, but I, and Dr. York would point out there is an additional Marine verse, but mostly ignored. Well, a primary aim of the letter to the Romans is to build up the believer's confidence in the truth of Paul's gospel that discloses the righteousness of God apart from the law. And if his gospel does uphold the law as he insists it does in 3:31, he has yet to explain why believers not only are discharged from the obligations in the old written law code, but must be released from the law if they're to bear fruit for God. He now sets out in this unit to show why the law has no role in the believer's salvation, but he must do so delicately so as not to disparage the law or imply that it led Israel up a blind alley. Paul defends his gospel against Jewish concerns that it devalues the law's holiness and seeks to persuade his audience that the law still has no part in God's saving purpose for humanity. This passage then leads into his argument in chapter 8 that the Spirit is God's alternative to the law and the antidote to the flesh. But from chapter 6, we learn that Paul locates participation in the new eon of salvation in the midst of solidarity with the old. Believers have died with Christ, but still have a death to die. They participate in Christ's risen life before their own bodily resurrection, which means that they still live in a pre-resurrection fleshly body. So we come to verse 7. Paul asks, "What then shall we say? That the law is sin?" And it's prompted by his assertion in 7:5 that while we were living in the flesh, our sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit for death. It seems that the Mosaic Law is the villain that abetted our bondage to sin. Such an inference is completely out of the question for Paul, and once again he's done a series of these rhetorical questions that he answers with a vehement no. The law is not sin, but it is related to sin. Paul explains, if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin. I would not have known what it is to covet if the law had not said, you shall not covet. Paul's citation of this command omits the specific list of items in Exodus and Deuteronomy that one is not to covet: your neighbor's wife, your neighbor's house, male or female slave, ox, donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. And by doing so, Paul makes the commandment applicable to every kind of coveting. To covet is to set one's heart on possessing for oneself something forbidden and not one's own, which leads to actions that are harmful to one's neighbor. Coveting is radical selfishness, the consuming desire to turn all things, God, other human beings, other creatures, the environment, to the service of my own interests, regardless of how it might hurt them. This commandment of all the Ten Commandments, therefore, is particularly apt as an example of how sin takes one captive. One might, for example, be able meticulously to keep the Sabbath holy, but everyone comes to grief trying to keep covetousness in check. In verse 8, Paul continues to personify sin as something that deceives, something that breeds death. When he learned from the law that coveting was a sin, sin took over and conjured up every desire within him. Mindfulness of the covenant commandments prohibition did not and does not curb fleshly urges. The verb to covet, by the way, is also in Greek, can be translated to lust. The flesh is a spawning ground for all manner of desires and envies. And these cravings usher in sin and enable it to set up a base of operation in the flesh that take command of a person's life. Sin then operates like a virus. You can tell I wrote this during a pandemic. It hijacks living cells to replicate, spread, and ransack the body. And as a virus can camouflage itself to hide from it, from as well as sabotage a cell's antiviral defenses, so sin can mask itself as innocuous. Oh, it can disable any resistance mechanism such as the conscience, and it can throw open all the doors for every manner of destructive evil to enter. Its effects are similar to the descriptions of the Dementors, the gliding, wraith-like, dark creatures in Harry Potter's series. J.K. Rowling writes, they infest the darkest, filthiest places. They glory in decay and despair. They drain peace, hope, and happiness out of the air around them. If it can, the Dementor will feed on you long enough to reduce you to something like itself, soulless and evil. While sin's stratagems are multifarious and the symptoms of its infection are manifold, its results are always the same: death. The commandment is not to blame for awakening sin from its dormancy. It is sin that incites disobedience by taking advantage of our creaturely condition and our vulnerability to its enticements. Sin may seem to be a coercing dark power behind our actions, but individuals do not escape culpability by blaming their plight on demon sin with a capital S. Eve blamed the serpent for deceiving her, but God did not absolve her from violating the commandment. Adam and Eve succumbed to temptation from a deep spiritual pride within them that made them want to be equal to God. It is not the law's fault that is incapable of changing the dark side of human nature or controlling its infatuations or furies. What the law can do, however, is expose our unrestrained desires for what they are: the self-absorbed, self-seeking, cutthroat desire for more and more. The I appears in the first person singular in verse 7. and in the pronoun me in verse 8, but Paul's sustained use of I beginning in verse 9 and the following verses makes this passage stand out from the rest of Romans and also from his other writings. It would seem obvious that Paul refers to himself, but many find it problematic that he would describe himself, a believer, as such a miserably insolvent sinner. It appears to controvert his assurances that believers had died to sin, 6:2, are no longer enslaved to it, 6:6, are freed from it, 6:7, are dead to it, 6:11. He has claimed that those who live under grace no longer live under sin's dominion, 6:14, are obedient from the heart, 6:17, have become slaves of righteousness, 6:18, and are slaves of God, 6:22. You get the point. Therefore, interpreters offer other options for who is speaking in this passage, and whether the speaker refers to the past or the present. Some contend that Paul speaks about his experience under the law before becoming a Christian. If Paul were speaking autobiographically about his earlier life in Judaism, however, he would seem to contradict his statements in Philippians 3:6 and Galatians 1:3-14. In these passages, he does not say that he felt despair over his inability to fulfill the law, but just the opposite. He surpassed others in zeal for the traditions of the fathers and considered himself to be blameless when it came to righteousness under the law. Others argue that after turning to Christ, Paul possessed a clear view of the law's inherent problems and God's purpose in giving it and the dangers of unenlightened zeal, so that now he assesses differently his former life. But why does he not make it clear that he is speaking here about his former life in Judaism as he does in Philippians and Galatians? This view surely founders on the statement that he was once alive apart from the law. Growing up a Jew, there was never a time when Paul was apart from the law. One could quibble that Paul refers to the time before he reached the age of accountability and became a bar mitzvah, son of the commandments, when he would have undertaken the demands of the law, but he does not describe his childhood innocence. Perhaps because Paul uses the vivid I for rhetorical effect as he adopts the persona of Israel and reflects retrospectively on her condition, struggling to obey the law apart from Christ. But if the I refers to Israel's experience under the law and the commandments first given at Mount Sinai, it is hard to imagine that Paul would say that Israel was alive apart from the law, and sin only sprang to life after they received the law from Moses' encounter with God on Mount Sinai. This claim is only true of Adam before the divine commandment resulted in Adam's expulsion from the garden when he transgressed it. It is also unlikely that Israel, in their current state of unbelief, would offer thanks to God through Jesus Christ our Lord for their future deliverance. An allusion to the Edenic story of Adam best explains Paul's use of the past tense in these verses. When Paul reflects theologically, he tends to theologize out of the story world of biblical narratives and then applies it to current situations. When he talks of faith, as he does in chapter 4, he thinks of Abraham, who epitomized faith. When he talks of law, as he does in 2 Corinthians 3, he thinks of Moses, who epitomized the law. When he talks about sin, as he does in Romans 5, 12 through 21, he thinks of Adam, who epitomized sin. In Romans 7, Paul harks back to the archetypal Adam story to reflect on the characteristic human response to the divine commandment. At least four echoes from the Edenic story emerge in these verses. First, the commandment, which is singular, recalls Genesis 2:16, etc. And Adam and Eve sinned only after God gave Adam the commandment not to eat of the fruit of the tree of life. Otherwise, sin would have remained dead because there was no command for them to disobey. Second, the image of sin taking opportunity recalls the serpent, sin's, a sudden appearance immediately after God issued the commandment. Third, the statement that sin deceived me echoes Eve's excuse for breaking the commandment when she says, "The serpent deceived me." And fourth, the connection between the sinful deed and death in 7, 9 through 11 recalls the penalty that God stipulated for violating the commandment. You shall surely die. Some interpreters claim that the true to life feature of the I narrative stems from Paul's use of speech in character. The technical term is prosopopoeia. That is, he impersonates Adam or Eve throughout the whole unit. The ancient rhetorical theorists, however, are unanimous that the speaker whose character is being represented always must be identified. It does not happen in this speech. Therefore, it is better, in my opinion, to see Paul reflecting in these verses on his own encounter with the Mosaic Law as a recapitulation of the primeval sin of Adam and Eve in the garden. In Adam's sin, Paul sees himself and his own experience with sin when confronted with God's command. In his own sin, he sees Adam, the representative of all sinful humankind. The I equals Adam equals Paul equals every human who rebels against God's commands and comes under death's grip. Everyone's sin may not be like the transgression of Adam, but the conflated story of Adam and Eve mirrors everyone's experience of being beguiled by sin. The serpent or sin, introduced as the craftiest of animals, con Eve in three ways that characterize sin's enduring ploys. First, it cited only the one negative command that God issued. Did God say you shall not eat from any tree in the garden? It deliberately ignored God's gracious beneficence, you may freely eat of every other tree of the garden. Second, it cajoled Eve into believing that God would not punish disobedience by death. You will not die. God's only bluffing. God's blasé about disobedience. Third, it used the commandment to sow seeds of doubt about God's goodwill. It claimed that God issued the command not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil because God did not want humans to become godlike. The serpent sweet-talked Eve into believing that she could be like God if only she were bold enough to rebel. The ruses work because the text says that the forbidden tree was a delight to the eyes. The serpent used the command to awaken covetousness, and in this case, wanting to be like God. The echoes from Genesis' account admirably serve to reveal how sin so easily seduces our fleshly nature, since the flesh finds so many things in the world eye-catching and alluring. As a result, fleshly humans continue to be taken in by sin's web of lies and ensnared in sin's web of death. The commandment in verses 10 through 11 does not refer only to the one commandment given to Adam in the garden, but now represents the whole law. The scriptures attest that the law was given as a way of life that leads to life. In providing a standard for what is right and wrong, the commandment does dispel moral indifference. But knowing what to do and what not to do does not enable one to obey. Sin is so powerful that it manipulates the law and, like a parasite, sucks the air out of the law's life-giving function so that it yields only a suffocating death. While Adam and Eve did not immediately die after transgressing God's commandment, their immediate alienation from God points to a spiritual death. After their expulsion from the garden, life east of Eden turned into a train wreck as sin and death pervaded all human existence. But Paul does not want the Roman audience to think that he scorns the law or teaches all the Jews living among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, as was rumored among some Jewish believers in Jerusalem, according to Acts 21. He says the law is holy, as are all the scriptures. Holiness means that it is pure, perfect, consecrated to the service of God. The law is just, reflecting the divine canons of what is virtuous and evil and representing the divine criteria about how we will be assessed at the final judgment. It is good, meeting all highest possible standards. But the law remains a problem. And so in the second unit in verses 13 through 25, which begins with another rhetorical question, did what is good then bring death to me? It receives another strong negative. The adjective good applies not just to the commandment, but to the whole law. The law's holiness is indisputable for Paul. But when sin establishes a foothold in the flesh, it twists what is given for Israel's well-being into a tool that churns out evil. The law is spiritual in what it prescribes, but it is not the Holy Spirit. It packs no spiritual punch to animate the behavior it prescribes. It reveals humanity's plight under sin's domination, but it is powerless to change it. Because the law operates in the sphere of the flesh, the law is severely handicapped. It cannot break sin's stranglehold. Sin manipulates the law to exploit the weakness of the flesh. But the law turns the tables on sin. It makes sinners accountable to God. It reveals that sin's final outcome is only death. But since the law only shows sin to be utterly sinful, it follows that God did not intend for the law to be sin's remedy or the path to salvation. And that is the fact, this fact is the main point of Paul in this entire section. In verse 13, he says, since our sinful passions are aroused by the law at work in our members to bear fruit of death in verse 5, and the very commandment that promised life proved death to me in verse 10, one might reasonably ask if the law is not a Trojan horse that is aligned with sin to bring death to us. Since the law is good, Paul says, this inference is wrong. It is also wrong to infer that God miscalculated in giving law since the results are so ruinous. The purpose clause in verse 13, in order that sin might be shown to be sin, and in working death in me throughout what is good, and the result clause, so that through the commandment sin might become sinful beyond measure. By the way, that's not the RSV translation, it's another. That implies that God foresaw what would happen. Paul hints that a quiet providence is at work, as God's purpose was to bring knowledge of sin through the law. And one can construe that purpose as being ultimately redemptive. Awareness of sin can strip away the thin makeup of fake righteousness that humans daub themselves with to dupe themselves and others that they are holy. When their sin sickness is fully exposed by the law and they acknowledge that they are in a desperate situation from which they cannot extricate themselves, it can make them more receptive to God's remedy. It comes only through what God has done in Christ and through the power of the Holy Spirit. In verse 14, Paul leaves the Edenic echoes that surface and switches to the present tense, to link the narrative to the present, which Paul shares with his readers. The law is holy, just and good, and now he adds that it is also spiritual. The problem is that he is fleshly. The translation here of the word sarkinos in the NIV, that he is unspiritual, is misleading. It is not just misleading, it's dead wrong. The adjective fleshly refers to his anthropological condition, being made of flesh and blood. Paul acknowledges that we are all creatures of clay with physical needs and appetites. Even when one's existence is in Christ, existence in an earthly body can levy an unavoidable encumbrance. In Gethsemane, Jesus rebuked his failed disciples who failed to watch as he had commanded and conceded, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Fleshly humans are intrinsically weak and powerless and sit perilously on the powder keg of sin that can explode at any time. Paul does not describe the anguish of humans in general who, apart from Christ, try to live by the law, but their inner passions drive themselves to act against their better judgment. Unregenerate persons do not delight in the law of God. They don't desire to do it, since they neither seek God in 3:11 or do they fear God in 3:18. Paul describes himself, a Christian, who is a creature of flesh and blood. And being flesh and blood, being fleshly, is part and parcel of our earthly existence. The problem for the law, which is spiritual, then, is that it operates in a fleshly realm where humans easily skid off its guiding rails into a quagmire of their innate frailty. In speaking about himself, Paul speaks for every believer who yearns to do God's will and falls short. Paul confesses to his past sin of violently persecuting the church and trying to destroy it, which he says makes him the least of all the apostles. But he does not say that since becoming a Christ follower, all sin is now behind him. The I in 1 Corinthians 13 represents a believer speaking. And Paul recognizes that this eye can become loveless and reduced to a clanking chunk of bronze or a clamorous cymbal. In Romans 7, the eye is the Apostle Paul speaking as an exemplar on our behalf to whom he writes. He does not stand apart from the addressees and lecture them on sin. Instead, he identifies with them in the struggle with sin. The you in 8:2, through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit that gives life, has set you free from the law of sin and death, reveals that he understands his experience to be also their experience as enfleshed human beings. Interpreters who dismiss this autobiographical interpretation, and there are many, they ask how Paul could possibly say that he is, as a believer, sold under sin. The paradox of being freed from sin and yet sold under sin reflects the tension between the already and the not yet. One does not become defleshed and transported to another dimension of existence upon becoming a believer. Our fleshliness means that we always have one foot in the old Adamic order, so that we belong at the same time both to the new and the old eons. The combat with sin continues after one becomes a believer, and our mortal flesh remains the arena of the daily bout between good and evil. This reality explains why Paul says, "I punish my body and enslave it so that after proclaiming to others, I myself should not be disqualified." Paul may be encouraged that although our outward man is decaying, yet our inward man is renewed day by day, but full deliverance from sin and its mortal sin awaits the resurrection. It takes place when this perishable body puts on imperishability, this mortal body puts on immortality, and when death has been swallowed up in victory. Until then, even after receiving the first fruits of the Spirit, believers will groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies, in 8:23. The I now in verse 15 becomes an active agent who wills to do what is good, but ends up doing what it hates. Against this tension, this tension does not depict the unregenerate person's conflict, since the eye's will aligns itself with God's law and the good. Paul is talking about himself and his quandary. He does not understand why he wills one thing and does another. Yet it happens. The fleshly eye is not the master of its actions. Sin has captured the will to do what is good and provokes one to commit actions that are at odds with what one knows to be good. Paul knows not to covet. He does not want to covet, but his actions reveal a deep-seated covetousness. As a fleshly human, he veers toward carrying out bodily appetites that lead to death, as if sin exerted some preternatural gravitational pull. This tension exposes the law's powerlessness to slay dragon sin, to convert the thou shalt and the thou shalt not into obedience. In verses 16 to 7, Paul recognizes that his actions do not correspond to his good intentions, but it testifies to the goodness of the law. The problem is that sin still has a branch office in his flesh that makes him incapable of obeying the law, an assertion that he keeps repeating in verse 20. Sin overwhelms the will and, like a puppeteer, pulls the strings of the body's members to perform what is morally wrong on life's stage. So Paul asserts that nothing good dwells in him. The whole I is implicated in sin. Paul does not believe that humans have a lower nature that sins and a higher nature that is capable of goodness. Fleshliness affects all human nature, and the law does not acquit anyone simply for willing to do what is right. It requires full obedience, and good intentions don't count. In verses 19 to 20, Paul does not allude to the unbeliever's quandary as Epictetus expressed it: what he wills, he does not do; what he does not will, he does. Or Ovid, who says, I approve the better course, yet I choose the worse. No, he is talking about a Jewish confidence. A Jewish confidence that if one willed to do the law, one could do it. Now, I could cite the passages from Sirach, Testament of Asher, the Psalm of Solomon, but let me just cite 4 Maccabees. In 4 Maccabees, it says this: not only is reason proved to rule over the frenzied urge of sexual desire, but also over every desire. Thus the law says, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or anything as your neighbor's. In fact, since the law has told us not to covet, I could prove to you all the more that reason is able to control desires. It's a Jewish point of view. Paul refutes this optimism. He's a Jew too. Paul refutes this optimistic view that an individual in the flesh has the power to obey the law. Even with knowledge from the law of what is good and the desire to do it, he still does what is wrong. The law may inform the will, and his mind may decide it is good to fulfill it, but a dark impulse within him leads him to transgress it. The will is captive to sin. It needs a greater power beyond itself and beyond reason to be able to fulfill the law. In verse 21, Paul summarizes his point, and it gets very complicated here. He refers to another law, a law in my members, etc. I have a long explanation of this, but I would just simply say that Paul is not referring to a principle. He is only referring to the law and the Mosaic law, and he understands the law in this case as under the sphere of the spirit, or the law under the sphere of the flesh. In one case, the law is under the mastery of the spirit, and the other, the law is under the mastery of sin, which directs it in the wrong direction. And so in verse 20, and I would also argue in verse 22, it's the key text. In his inmost self, Paul understands and subscribes to and delights in and desires to do what the law says. His joyful agreement with the law echoes the psalmist. My lips, this is Psalm 119, my lips will pour forth praise because you teach me your statutes. My tongue will sing of your promise, for all your commandments are right. Let your hand be ready to help me, for I have chosen your precepts. I long for your salvation, O Lord, and your law is my delight. The problem is that being at one's rational best is never sufficient. Paul is unable in his fleshly condition to turn his delight into obedience, any more than David was able. It is important to parse carefully Paul's wording in verse 23. Paul does not understand himself to be captive to sin per se, but he is captive to the law of sin which is in my members. He understands that his corporality makes him still vulnerable to sin's cancerous, metastasizing progression. It means that freedom from slavery, which believers have been gifted in Christ, is not yet possessed as an anthropological phenomenon. Why else does he exhort his audience to pray to God not to let sin exercise dominion over their mortal bodies, to make you obey their passions? Or why else does he command, no longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from life to death, from death to life? Paul lays, in verse 24, Paul lays bare his profound anguish over his helpless fleshly condition. He is wretched. It reminds us for our hymn, Amazing Grace, that saved a wretch like me, but sometimes people want to change that wretch to something else like they did. Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? But he believes himself to be a wretch. He inhabits a body of death that is totally subject to the power of death in this world. He finds himself incapable of obeying the law as he wants, and the law offers no solution, creating what would seem to be a fatal impasse. He longs for deliverance from the endless war and frequent defeat. And caught in the overlap of the two ages, he pleads for deliverance from this body of death and its congenital weakness. It is important to know that Paul does not ask, what will deliver me? What will rescue me? He asks, who will deliver me? Paul Holloway asserts that the tyranny of desire is not a philosophical problem to be solved by the application of a rational therapy, nor is it a problem of moral ignorance to be solved by more instruction at the seminary. I added that point. The law offers no deliverance from this fallen condition and only metes out death as the punishment for transgression. What humans need is a divine savior and a divine power to overcome sin's stranglehold and to harness mutinous impulses and to transform them into obedience. Spoiler alert, that deliverer is Christ. And in verse 25, Paul says, thanks be to God's gracious initiative. He exalts that deliverance will come through Jesus Christ. The thanksgiving in 1 Corinthians 15, 56 through 57, I think provides a close parallel. Paul mentions the sting of death, sin, and the law as the power of sin, and then rejoices, thanks be to God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. The victory in 1 Corinthians 15, 57 clearly refers to the future deliverance of believers in the resurrection. So it follows that the reference to being rescued in 7:25 also refers to the believer's future, deliverance from this present body of death. Weighted down as he is with a sense of his own wretchedness, as he lives in constant tension between what he is in the flesh and what he is in Christ, he throws his gaze forward to the decisive event, which alone can bring the tension to an end. Through the Lord Jesus Christ means that his deliverance will transpire only for those who, by the grace of God, are joined to Christ and his resurrection. And it is only the wretched person who fully understands and fully appreciates God's grace in Christ. Now, there's a negative statement that follows this in verse 25. Many commentators think it's out of place. It's a gloss. There's no textual evidence, however, to support these suppositions. The text has to be interpreted as it stands, and I would argue that this is something that appears all the way through Romans. That the second half of this verse serves as a delayed conclusion to what precedes. This is something that happens elsewhere. And what it basically means is I myself, or I dependent on myself alone, am fundamentally in need of help to obey the law and to please God. This is not then an expression of salvation to begin. As Jimmy Dunn says, it is the process, the beginning of the process of salvation that is underway and still to be completed. Let me say that again. It is not an expression of salvation still to begin, but of the process of salvation that is underway and still to be completed. After showing that none could obey God's commands on their own power and the law is powerless to help, Paul then shows in chapter 8 that believers can do so only through the Spirit, and only through the Spirit of God dwelling in them. Therefore, Paul is making an implicit command to believers to live in the sphere of the Spirit of Christ, who alone is able to counteract the flesh that calls humans to fail and to fall into the clutches of sin. Many believers find in this passage a telling description of their own struggles. We still are mortal beings, not yet freed from the ravenous maw of evil longings and ambitions, no matter how much we try to deny, whitewash, or repress them. Luther's comment remains apropos. Indeed, it is a great consolation to us to learn that such a great apostle was involved in the same grievings and afflictions in which we find ourselves when we wish to be obedient to God. Others have chimed in, how can we doubt that this is true for Paul when it is so true for us? These comments capture why Paul uses the I in this section. He confesses to his audience that he is like them. He doesn't stand above them, he stands amongst them as a sinner. He understands that the old man has been buried in baptism, but he sure can swim. Sin's stubborn virus can lie dormant but revive and cause a relapse, that the old self buried in baptism comes back to life. As a result of this, all of us will face the inescapable sting of death. But Paul will insist in chapter 8 that while sin may remain, it need not reign. I hope you see I quoted Luther, and this is John Wesley. Don't throw them out with a new perspective. We can join Paul in giving thanks to God, though we will not escape the death which is the fruit of our sin. We are able to survive it because Christ has endured it with us and for us. The hymns that I included, I wish we could sing. That first hymn is right out of Romans 7, but it has a fourth verse. And then look at the words, that it is well with my soul.